Good evening. You know, when I come to an event like this, I often wonder, you know, what is it that I should talk about? Because I remember an incident when I was CDO of the bank and I had organized an executive program in which we had asked Duke University to make the arrangements, and they had sourced some of the best global experts from across the globe. Now, after 4 days of intense deliberations, when I felt almost everything that the management experts said were something that needed to be actioned, after about 3 weeks, I found that I didn't remember a single thing, excepting about one person who had said that when you go into a meeting, be sure you have an agenda, and when you come out of it, be sure you have noted the action points. That's the only thing I remembered. So I'm sure, you know, whatever I say today, you'll probably forget in 24 hours. But that's all right. You know, let's still talk about, you know, a few things from my own life, which I feel, you know, probably something that you would like to know about or maybe help yourself, you, in the way forward. One thing that I have always found that has stood me in very good stead is the fact that, you know, you need to continuously challenge yourself. Challenge yourself in doing whatever you have not done before, going wherever you have not gone before. A status quo is something that sort of creeps up on you and makes you complacent, and then you find the time has gone by and you have really not got to where you have got. Let me just give you a small example. You know, when I got married, my husband was in IIT Kharagpur, and I requested my office to post me to the IIT branch. Now, that branch at that point of time had severe IR problems. You know, banks were heavily unionized at one point of time before all of this computerization came in. And managing branches was considered to be very, very difficult. And this was a branch where the unions had card-carrying members of certain political parties. And it was very, very difficult to manage them. So, you know, the chief of HR actually called me and said that, Arundhati, reconsider. Do you really want to go there? So I said, sir, what's the problem? You know, it helps me in my personal life to get there. And he said, well, you know, the last branch manager, they took him by his collar and pulled him out of his seat and put him outside the room. So I thought about it for a little while, and then I told him, sir, I don't have a collar, so probably they won't be able to do that to me. Now, the fact is, you know, I went there. And of course, it was a very, very difficult situation because the branch manager also didn't have any faith that I would do a good job being a woman. And he resisted very, very strongly about my coming in over there. But as circumstances happened, he needed to get rid of the current accountant. So suddenly he changed track and he welcomed me in. It was a very, very difficult situation. But I found that there are ways of getting around this difficult situation as well. And maybe, you know, if I share some of those tips, they will help you. One of the things I found is that everybody is scared of giving anything in writing. So, you know, if somebody is misbehaving and you get the customer to come and put a written complaint along with a witness to it, and you issue a memo on that, immediately as the memo is getting typed, people will come in and become absolutely compliant to whatever you want and apologize till the cows come home. So this was one very good way of managing things. And in fact, you know, a lot of people keep asking me that, you know, in this long careers of yours, so many people must have asked you to do so many things. How did you go about doing them? How did you go about managing not doing them? Because doing them is easy and not doing them is far more difficult. And I've found always that asking people to give things in writing is one way of not doing something which you shouldn't be doing. Because people, if they're asking you to do something that you shouldn't be doing, will definitely not give it to you in writing. So believe me, this is a tip that you should always use, because this is something that's going to stand you in very good stead as you go along. The other thing is, if you really dare yourself to do new things, I have found that it also helps in many other ways. For instance, it managed to convince my husband, who, when he married me, he thought he was marrying somebody who normally works in the counter, on a winter afternoon during lunch hour, plays badminton or knits wool, and at 5 sharp comes home. So he married me with that idea of what a bank employee is like. He actually got mixed up between a clerical staff and an officer. Can't blame him, didn't know the bank. So, you know, that's the idea he had. And obviously, you know, this means he had always heard banks pay well. In those days, it was supposed to be good payment. And limited hours, so he would still have his hot roti in the for dinner. Okay, instead he got a person who's working probably 12 hours a day, and the stress levels are, you know, sort of enough to raise the roof. So sometimes I used to ask him, what is it that made you support me in spite of the fact that you got a package that was so different from the one that you imagined you'd get? And he used to tell me, well, one thing I really appreciated was the fact that you always dared yourself. You always took up challenges. For you, it was not a time pass, it was a career. And that you were really and truly trying to achieve things. So I think, you know, if you really put yourself out there, if you really stretch that extra mile, you will find that you get the support of not only your colleagues, but also your family people. Again, very, very important if you are to get anywhere in life. So it's important for you to remember this, that as you go on in your career, if you find that you're doing very well and you're really well settled, remember it's time to change. I always used to tell my women colleagues that the moment you have found a good tailor to sew a blouse and you have found a good hairdresser to cut your hair, it's time to change. Because then you've been in that place long enough. It's time to get away and do something different. Okay? Now, in order to do this, in order to do what I'm asking you to do, you have to be comfortable with yourself. That means you must neither overestimate nor underestimate yourself. You know, for instance, crossing the Niagara on a tightrope may be talent, but not doing it is intelligence, right? So also, for you, don't overestimate your capabilities. But that doesn't mean that you underestimate it either. While you shouldn't overestimate it, I know several people who end up underestimating themselves, and the result of that is neither good teamwork nor proper delegation. For instance, I used to have a lady in one of my assignments. She was one of the best IT professionals I had in the department. Basically, IT used to ride with her. Now this lady, she would take 2 weeks off before each of her son's exams, the annual exam and the half-yearly exam. And during those 2 weeks, all of our people would be scurrying around like headless chicken. So you know, the first time it happened, I managed it. Second time it happened, I waited for her to come back and I told her, you know, the promotion exercises are just around the corner and you for one are not getting promoted. So she was absolutely shocked, like, you know, what are you talking? I'm the best person there is. And I said, yes, you are, but the problem with you is you never tell your team what you're doing. You don't train them. As a result, when you are not away, I am not able to manage. And at the end of the day, we are talking about real-time system over here. I can't afford for you to come back after 2 weeks and then set things right. So if you're not able to manage the team, you're not going to get anywhere, and I really cannot promote you. So, you know, she came very high and mighty and so she said, this is my IPR. So I said, fine, with your IPR, please go into a research lab. Don't be in a bank. Because in a bank, you can't afford to have things like that, which you can afford to do in research, because this is a real-time organization. So then ultimately, you know, in her conversation, I really realized what actually was bothering her. What was bothering her was the fact that she felt that if she allowed her team to function just as well without her, then she would no longer be required. It was a sense of an inferiority complex rather than a superiority complex that was driving her behavior. But her behavior was such that it was really making the whole thing dysfunctional. So I actually told her that, look, you have to understand that you are really, really important. You are important to the organization. And what you need to do is you have to be like salt. Like salt in what sense? That the opposite of salt, in the sense that when you are there, I must know you are there. When you are not there, I must not feel your absence. Just the way we consider salt in food, but just the opposite way. In the sense, you don't realize when salt is there in your food, but you do realize it when it is not there. But for a person who's really worth it, I must realize it when he or she is there, but I must not feel her absence when he or she isn't. And this applies to both home and family. And therefore, in order to ensure that both home and family work as a team and step up to the plate when you are around, you aren't around, what you really need to be do is to be kind. And this is very, very important for us to understand that being kind is a very small thing. It's not something extraordinary or extra special. Maybe when you get into the lift and you see your neighbor, just say a cheery good morning. If you find that somebody, say the neighbor's mother or somebody is carrying a heavy package, just carry it for her. Maybe when you get into office and you find that somebody is really looking very low, call them into the office and ask them what is the matter with them. So being kind doesn't mean doing big, big things, but being kind means actually looking after the welfare of the people around you. Because I'll tell you, this is the difference between having a really low day and having somebody reach out to make that day a little better. So unless and until you are able to have that kind of a feeling for others, you are not going to be able to have the team operating in a way that you would want them to operate, and a team operating in a manner to ensure that your priorities are right. And as you look at those priorities, your work still doesn't get hampered, your family life still doesn't get hampered. And this is absolutely important for you to realize. But while you're being kind to others, be kind to yourself as well. Don't hold yourselves to very, very high standards. I know a lot of women who really agitate the fact that, you know, they are getting late, so how will the dinner be made at home, and, you know, they have to go back and they have to ensure that, you know, everything is correct. Now, the fact of the matter is that it's okay, you know, even if the men, if they forget their wife's birthday once in a while, it's all right. So also for the women, if you're not able to be there for dinner for the family, it's perfectly fine. What you need to do is to set your standards yourself, not, you know, to go by society's standards. Society mandates that you must remember your spouse's birthday. Well, society may mandate that once in a while. You might be so worried you've forgotten it. So what? Don't beat yourself about it. It's okay. And if you do that, if you are kind to yourself as well, you'll find that overall stress levels will come down. Overall, you'll be in a position to operate much better. Now, one other thing I'll tell you that has helped me immensely is to keep learning. You know, when I first became the chairman and I was invited to a lot, to these conferences and all, most people, you know, they would read out, when as they were introducing somebody, they'd read out their academic achievements. When they came to me, normally they would just say, she's a postgraduate, blah, 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 and go on. Now, the fact of the matter is I realized that they were feeling a little embarrassed about saying I'm a postgraduate in English when I'm heading a finance company, that too a Fortune 500 company. So I realized at that point of time that no matter how much you learn and how well you get there, it is important to get the certifications as well. Y'all have got the degrees and the diplomas today which you need to get. I will say that I was very lucky that I got away even without those certifications. But don't believe in that kind of luck, you may not be so lucky. So even if you have got one of the best degrees and diplomas today, remember that you must continue this process. This is not the end of learning, this is not the end of exams. Exams you'll continue to give in your regular life as well as in your academic persuasions throughout your life. Remember that and do it well. Of course, you know, one thing is that because I have a degree in English and I've headed a finance company, I get invited to a lot of people to speak about how I did it. You won't get that opportunity maybe, but doesn't matter. In your own work and in your own career, you will definitely be able to make a mark if you can continue to learn and if you can continue to ensure that that learning is properly noticed by the people around you. Now, one other thing I have always also felt, you know, that in a stress situation, the best thing that works is humor. Some anonymous quote is there that humor is the lubricant of life, and I truly believe that. I have used it often. And if you are in a situation which has become very tense, this is one of the best way of releasing that tension. For instance, in that Kharagpur branch, you know, It was one of the most busiest branch at that point of time. Loads of students like y'all who would draw 20 rupees per day and therefore crowd up the branches like anything. So, you know, those kinds of things were always there. And the number of people I had compared to that, the number of customers we were serving was great. And in those days, we used to have these huge ledgers, not the screens of today. And the ledgers would pile up so fast in front of my desk that most of the time I'd have to stand up and work. Otherwise, I wouldn't be seen. I'm not very tall, obviously. So, you know, I had to stand up and work. And as I finished the ledger, some messenger was supposed to take it away. Now, I would never ever find these messengers. They'd come and dump it on my table, but forget to take it away. Or rather, just slack off. So I'd have to keep, you know, sort of plunking the ledgers onto the floor. And this used to really get me, you know, that they're not doing their job. And one of these days, the matter got really, really tense. You know, I became really mad at them. What the hell are you all doing? And then the branch manager suddenly comes and asks me, you know, it's time for duty rotation. Which messenger do you want? Now, here I'm having a fight with the messengers because they aren't working. And he comes and asks me which one I want. So, you know, I just looked at him and I said, you know, out of these 16 chaps, 10 of them have the names of gods. Like, you know, one was named Mahadev, one was named Narayan, one was named Hare Krishna, stuff like that. So 10 of them had names of that sort. So I said, you know, out of the 10, you give me anyone. So, you know, the messengers who were fighting with me and the branch manager, they all looked at me. What on earth is she talking about? So I said, you know, first of all, you, the branch manager, you don't give me a single minute even to take God's name. And these messengers are making my life even more miserable. So while I'm taking their names, I will actually be multitasking. I'll take God's name and if they come, good for me. But the only thing is everybody started laughing so much that the whole matter, you know, the tense atmosphere, that got relaxed immediately. So the fact is, you know, in life as you go on, there will be times when your spouse will be angry, when your child will feel you have not done enough for them. There will be times when your peer group will feel that you're not doing the right things. These are the times when you really need to step up and find the funny thing in the situation. And if you do that again, believe me, you will find that ultimately it works very much better. Because raising of stress levels in a workplace is not something that is conducive to productivity at all. In fact, when I went in and became the chairman, a lot of people came and told me, especially my peer group, ki abhi to thoda bahut danda chalana padega, tumse to aata nahi hai, tum kaise manage karogi? So I said, dekho, I'm at the end of my career, abhi danda chalana aayega nahi, I won't be able to do it even if I want it. But I don't believe that's required, it's not required. If you really trust people, if you give them their space, if you ensure that it's a stress-free environment, if you ensure that people, when they get up in the morning, they want to come and work with you, that's the best way of getting things done. Not creating such a stressful atmosphere that people want to curl up in bed and cover themselves with a blanket instead of getting up and coming to office. So whatever you do, try and ensure that you create an environment around you that's stress-free, because that is what is going to make things most productive. The last two things that I'll say is that if you are going to be a leader, remember, you need depth as well as breadth, okay? Just being specialists in one thing is not going to give you the strength of leadership. And in order to get that breadth, what you normally have to do is you have to stretch your helping hand to people who, for whom you are not directly responsible. Because as you improve your area of functioning, as you increase your area of influence, the more breadth you will get. And while you are doing that, there will be lots of people who will be saying that this is one person who can be relied upon in any kind of an emergency, even if that person is not really directly responsible for delivering on it. But what you get out of those experiences are what is going to give you those leadership roles as you go ahead. So remember that depth is required, but so is breadth. And of course, you know, in whatever you do, you've got to be passionate. Without passion, things don't work. You will be asked to make many, many sacrifices. Believe me, in this life, as you go along, as you pursue either, you know, great things within your family or within your office, there will be sacrifices to be made. Now, those sacrifices, unless and until you're passionate about what you're doing, they will not make sense. You know, there is a saying that Steve Jobs had said this, that you have to be burning with an idea or a problem or a wrong that you want to right, if you are not passionate enough from the start, you will never stick it out. And that is very, very true. So unless and until you're passionate about something, unless and until you really feel from your heart that this is what I want to do, I would suggest that you go ahead and find something else to do. You have to look around and see what really enthuses you, really gives you that adrenaline high, you know, keeps you on that high. That is what is going to ensure that you get where you want to get. That is, you want to get ahead of the pack, and that is how it is going to happen. Now, these are all things, little tips that I have used in my life and I have shared with you, and I'm sure it will take you about 24 hours to forget this. But there are one or two things I do not want you to forget, and I want to talk about that. The first thing is that today you have all experienced a measure of success, right? You all are successful in having completed a very prestigious course in one of the most prestigious institutions of the country. You probably have already a very good job. Now, in order to get you that success, there have been sacrifices that have been made by your family members as well as by you. There has been a lot of hard work done by you as well as your faculty. And of course, you know, along with all of this, the hard work and the sacrifices, you have also had a modicum of luck. You cannot deny that. Like, you know, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, I think, once said that your weight is your karma, but your height is your destiny. So similarly, whatever you do, no matter what karma you do, you have a little bit of destiny over there. So you are also very lucky. Now, because great opportunities, great luck also brings with it great responsibility, you have to remember a few things. For every one of you sitting over here, there are thousands others that will never have this opportunity, though they may have deserved it. They will never have it. And therefore, the fact that you have had this experience, the fact that you have had this luck, makes it incumbent upon you to take on that responsibility. And what responsibility is that? The responsibility of ensuring that the country, that this country, the economy of this country, to which you all can contribute hugely, that that economy rises to its potential. Because across the world, if you have seen anywhere, unless and until a country's economy is doing well, that country will not be respected. You cannot demand respect. You cannot demand respect on the basis of something that may be history. You have to have achievements now. And only if India produces world-beating companies are we going to get that respect. Now, y'all are the people who should be thinking about producing those world-beating companies. Y'all are the people that should provide the leadership to ensure that the companies that we have in India, that the Indian economy gets to benefit from your knowledge, from your expertise, and that you all are going to create those companies. So you may be going out for a job, you may be looking at a business opportunity, whatever it is. Remember, that is just a step in your journey. You must take a pledge today, that I will not be the user of value, I will be the creator of value. That I will not be a job seeker, I will be a job creator. That I will not be a follower, I will be a leader. This pledge I want you to take today. This pledge I want you to take today so that you remember at every point in your life, whenever you are wondering what is to be done and what is next, remember this pledge that I requested you to take, that you will create value, that you will create jobs, that you will be a leader. India needs it badly. India today needs it badly. You have only about 20 years. If we do not grow at more than double digits in 20 years, India will never be a medium income country for the next 80 to 100 years. We don't have any time to waste. And not only must you do this, but most importantly, do it ethically. Very, very important. Remember these three things only, what I am asking you to do and how to do it, and I think I will have done my duty of having come here and spoken to you. Thank you again for this opportunity. God bless.